Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Well, let me look at this thing. I'll go talk to this guy over here, whatever his name is. Folded library card? No, that's not it. Before it needs a white envelope. Okay, we need to interact. This is the one that Everard Clare gave us last episode. He wants two episodes, one from Vivienne and one from somebody else. You take the legal documents out of the envelope, a 12 to 40 month construction period, and the zoning plan in the addendum. Okay, so apparently he wants to build a youth community center, but I don't fully trust it. Apparently he doesn't want to knock down any homes, but just that the construction will be noisy during that time. Look at the zoning plan. The youth center cuts into the ocean like the bow of some great modern ship. Apparently it's going to cover most, if not all, of the street and the square between the existing houses. It's three stories tall. Visual calculus says it's going to be awfully close to the already existing buildings, almost wall to wall, practically integrating them into the youth center. And this wasn't going to be simple. Inland Empire says this is either ominous or cool architectural choice. Hard to say. Conceptualization says my money is on cool. Looks like a cubic pyrite. Alright, so my brain is divided on this. Kim, what do you think of this? I'm no property lawyer, but it looks fine, the lieutenant replies, flipping through the documents. I like the print size. They're not selling or leasing anything. It's not a perfect solution, but... He shrugs. Frederick says, how else are you going to build something? It's always inconvenient to build things, and citizens inevitably have disagreements over such construction projects, but there's no other way. Logic? I have a good chance of beating this. Try to find a loophole in the deal. Plus one to centers very close to houses in ominous shape. Minus one to cool cubic pyrite. So my own conceptualization is hindering me here. Try to find a loophole. Success. There is no loophole. The simple truth is the current residents are going to lose their street access, and for the next 12 to 40 months their lives will be dominated by constant construction noise right next door. Wait, what are the ramifications of this? Once the construction starts, it'll probably take a few months, a year maybe, for even the most stubborn occupants to get tired of living like this. After that, they'll sell their property for cheap and move out. Look, Kim, these people are going to have to move away. Can we do something about it? I should have seen it. The lieutenant frowns as he reads over the document again. I guess your logic didn't work for you. Everard probably has eyes on us, but he pauses to think. We could try to get other people to sign this instead of those listed, or you could forge their signatures yourself. By the time he finds out, we'll already be gone. Very low. Minus 10. Everard's people could be watching you here. Yeah, don't do it here. Can't be retried either. Put the documents back. Hi.
Oh, hey, mister. I need to be back to talk with O'Lear here. Yes, I did. Yes, I did. It's like Lady Larice said when she opened a bathhouse in the basement of my apartment building. They can only get so far before they're aching to get back. Mm. And a lot of folks really did keep coming back.
Alright, I thought he'd have something new to say that we talked to Everard, but nope, not this time. What's this? Oh, yeah. Get two signatures for Everard. Find someone to sign the document instead of the intended signees, or forge the signatures, but somewhere private where you feel safe enough to sleep. Well, the place where I sleep is in the fishing village itself. But I don't think it has to be there. Somewhere indoors, with the door closed, at least. Okay. Forgetting how we're getting around over here. So I don't get why he said we needed a card to get back, and I actually agreed with him. We needed a car to get in here. Hopefully that little trumpet thing doesn't sound over here. It's usually by the hotel. Alright, so we're gonna talk to Measurehead. I feel like saving first. Looking monolithic. The race pupil returns. Measurehead makes all men quiver. Just look at him, the wonderful hunk.
Do not presume this has drastically altered our race dynamic.
It was just something I had to do. Our personal dynamic has changed. He pauses for a second. A little. Authority says he means very little. Ephrat told you to help us get the body down from the tree. So it was. You bested me in race combat to reach my superior, then had him give me an order. I salute your cunning, enemy. I will go and remove the body from the tree with my bare hands. You're so noble, Measurehead, his babe says. Rhetoric says there's a but. But, while I am gone, someone must stand guard on the bridge. That someone needs to be you. He turns to Kim. Both of you. Authority says that would mean you're openly showing the people that you're taking the Union's side. Wait, that means showing everyone that we're taking orders from the Union. Yes, that is precisely what it means, homunculus. This is not going to happen any other way. Lieutenant, what if we don't want to do that? This is the uncomfortable result of not taking it down ourselves. I can live with the compromise. Listen to your little friend. He is wise in his childlike way. His mysterious race may yet prove fierce competition to my heroic haplogroup. Okay. Alright then. Wait here while he goes. Babe, see that they stay here the whole time. Is this gonna be boring as hell? We have to stand here all day? Or is time just gonna magically pass? Who else is gonna want to get past? We have to guard the button. The button of doom. The woman's gaze follows Measurehead as he leaves. She turns to you. So, you guys are like cops or something? Yeah, we're the law around here. Cool. I like men with guns and power. The woman twirls her hair. I'm Katya, by the way. Oh, you actually have a name. You hear that? Lieutenant looks toward the yard. That sound. He's breaking something. Yeah, Jean-Luc must be really tearing it up over there. I wish I could see it. I don't. I've seen enough of that dead body already. Scab leader says, "Look at you, RCM Renacops!" A loud voice booms in from below. Guarding the bridge like Everard's lapdogs? Is this where it's at now? The RCM is for sale? And who are you? The lieutenant fires back. What is your business here? Why are your clothes four sizes too small for you? That's none of your business. I'm just standing here. A shrill laughter interrupts you, echoing across Martinez. It's Kuno. Perception hearing tells us that. And then the man turns to look behind him at the behemoth appearing around the corner, approaching him, walking past him. Well, that was quick. No one got past the button. The corpse has been removed from the tree. He brushes wooden flakes off his hands. Stand down and congratulate yourself. You have sided with the race victory today. There's been no side choosing. We did what we had to do to keep order. Measurehead nods slowly. And what you had to do was to become a Union man for all to see. Alright, whatever. More than enough to please a woman. Everyone should try to be more like Measurehead. That's alright. Measurehead crushes all, including a tree, apparently. I guess that's incompleted? Getting the body down. Go to the yard and see what Measurehead accomplished. Too bad we weren't able to successfully shoot it down. Does this guy have anything new to say?
So, how'd you like our harbor?
He stares at you with his hazy eyes. Frederick says, you've been in there, he means. Talk to the boss man too, probably. It was nice enough. It's but a rest area on the path leading across open plains, he notes solemnly, then turns to you, a wide smile adorning his face. Right. You talk to the boss, eye to eye, like men of the plain. If you have any more questions, I'm set to talk. Who do you think killed the hangman? The mercenary, aye? He shrugs. Who could have killed him? That's indeed the question. Why even do such a thing? He shakes his head solemnly. Everard says Titus Hardy and his boys killed him. That's so. The man twirls his mustache around his finger. I haven't heard anything about that, but if that's true, well, he was an easy combatant. Hold up, what does that mean? He was an agent of the opposition, attempting to undermine our honorable efforts. Were you involved in his death? I ain't the murdering type, but that's just me. Large organizations like our Union have all sorts of men, with all sorts of skills. Drama says he believes the Hardy boys could have done it. Understood. Lieutenant takes a note. This has been of limited use. Still, thank you. No problem. I wish the best to you and your search. Search. Sure I'm glad it's not my search. He takes a sip from his flask. Do I dare talk to this guy? Down here? I don't know why I'm bothering.
Went native on the chief, huh? Those ballerina antics were reckless. Should've just punched him in the throat again.
Oh, he approves of that, though. Should've stayed in the damn sawmill. He nods in approval. Physical instrument says wrong. You did the right thing with Measurehead. The ballerina antics won you the fight.
Let's talk about our right to work!
He pauses and abruptly changes the subject. Alright. Never mind. I thought he'd have something to say about us standing up there with the Union. But he just mentioned us beating Measurehead. Alright. That came up again. I was saying, still... What the hell I was saying. I have to turn that theme off because every time it plays, even for like two, three seconds, I'll get a hit on the video and, you know. Copyright claim. Let me just see something. Is this still? Speed train Kuno, leaving station. Well, there's the body. Now, maybe something different will be playing? Let me just see. Let's get out of here, Kuno. Yeah, just... I don't want to miss the other interesting musical cues. Well, I've got the body down. What's up, Kuno?
You missed it at show before! A kift came by, completely fucked a tree to pieces.
Gotta love his way of putting things.
He fucked the tree up. Fucked it good. It was porno.
It was porno, huh? Rhetoric says, if you want to shut it down, you need to act decisively. It's Kuno. Use Kuno words. Let's let Kuno... Is retard... I guess retard is a Kuno word. It's not... a curse word. Total retards use language like that. Congratulations, Kuno. You just made yourself a retard. Stop choking, Kuno. The Fagari's got you in a chokehold. Kuno's not choking. He grabs his throat like he's choking. Choked you out there. Serves you right for using reactionary crap. Like hell you did. Let's go of his throat. Kuno's gonna keep saying kipped forever now. Kipped, kipped, kipped. He only gets two kips out before he coughs. Crap, he stops. The hell did you want anyway? You got your bag down, or let's talk normal crap. Yeah, let's have normal conversation. Shoot the crap at Kuno, pig-o-naut. Do I want those pants that badly? That's more than half our money. Yeah, I'm not... The drug boss is strictly optional. We're not dealing with him, at least not yet. I'm off, whatever. Alright, so we got the body down. You know, talk to it again? The corpse lies on the ground among the remains of an absolutely demolished pinewood branch. It's gently laid on one side. Well, it's down. Sweet, I level up. Kim says, Mr. Measurehead has done a good job. The lieutenant nods approvingly. Nothing is too broken or compromised. The victim is ready for a field autopsy. A field autopsy? Yes, he covers his nose and lists. 1. Investigation of the scene. 2. Initial examination of the victim. 3. Field autopsy. 4. Transportation of the body to the morgue. We're on number 3. Encyclopedia says, the RCM's 4-phase murder scene processing manual. The hell they on about? Kuno says. Cop's gonna cut his crap up. Don't we have someone else to cut his crap open? It's not about cutting, Kim squints at the corpse. And no, you and I are detectives. The honorary rank of detective signature signifies our ability to handle the entire incident chain, from autopsy to cleanup to social work. Wait, honorary rank of detective? An honor and a burden attached to your rank, which you've proven yourself able, usually after 5 to 8 years of field work. Mine is Lieutenant Detective. Huh. Yes, I feel like I'm a detective. You are. Your station would not have assigned you on this case if you weren't. Now, the lieutenant adjusts his glasses and takes a deep breath. First, what exactly is a field autopsy? Come on, officer. He pulls on a pair of latex gloves. You know what a field autopsy is. You've done 100 of them. Encyclopedia says, what you do know is, at 18.9 kilometers, the dormant shield volcano Corpus Mundi is the world's highest summit, and the failure of the 38 single at Puy du Sang to crack the top 20 was the death knell of disco. But what a field autopsy is? You have no idea. Why don't you know? What use are you? I'm talking encyclopedia, though. You must have me confused with the Capopedia. Who's the Capopedia? I think I need to talk to him. You, sir. You are the Capopedia. Do you have another pair of gloves? Unfortunately, no. I have gardening gloves. Maybe they're enough? They're better than nothing. Lieutenant looks at the gloves. Tell you what, I perform the anatomical side of things while you will take notes. Good. I'm glad you have the honor of that, quote-unquote. We just fill this in, right? Show him the red field autopsy form in your ledger. That's right, he nods. Empathy says, you knew it because you inspected your ledger. The lieutenant is relieved you know the protocol. Open your ledger at the field autopsy form. The dead man stares in silence as you crack open the ledger. The bright red paper is covered in boxes and lists, describing the condition of his skin and organs in three parts. Above those, an 11-field info form needs filling out first. It begins with... Begin. 1. Assistant. That's you. Okay. Tequila Sunset. Right. Harrier Dubois, Lieutenant Double Euphrator. The corpse is indifferent to your scribblings, just lies there. The next box says Coroner 2, Coroner's case number. Okay, Kim says a KK57 etc. number. KK equals Kim Katsuragi, 57 equals Precinct 57, followed by his date 0803 and time of arrival 0815 on the scene. He's indexed the case after himself, not you. Rhetoric says, that's because he doesn't want to bring up the messy question of your initials. Fine, whatever, write it down. Next, 3, name. We've heard a nom de guerre, Lely. It's better than nothing. Write it down. Write Lely. What's next? Date of birth? 4, date of birth, nod. N.A. 5. Age. The man corrects his glasses. Roughly 50. Visual calculus says, try 40. The damage is so extensive, it's better to err on the young side. I'm gonna write estimate 42. Kim nods. 6. Race. Kim says, Mondial. Encyclopedia says, fair to olive skin from the Isola of Mundi. This is as vague as it gets. You might as well say whitish. Write it down. The hanged man. The pudgy mess of curdled meat looks neither mondial nor anything other. 7. Sex. Kunoes. The little monster exclaims energetically. Kim says male. Kuno says, pig's gonna have sex? Write it? No. I can't do that. Right. Okay. Okay. I am so tempted. No. Male. Nor does he look male with his pregnant belly and indistinguishable face. 8. Date of death. We're still going with March 4th, 51. Okay. 3, 4, 51. That's for people in the United States. Yeah, this is the way Europe writes it. Kim says, what else? He looks over your shoulder. 9, body identified by is non-applicable. 10, case number is the same as the coroner's case. KK blah 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 listens motionless with the cargo belt still around his neck. Only one box remains. 11, evidence of treatment. Kim says none, at least not after the initial examination. What exactly is treatment, anyway? Interfering with the body's position or wounds post-mortem. Authority says, how did you not know that? Aren't you a cop? You're leaving a weak impression here. Say something sure-handed. I'm not so sure. Didn't the footprints look like he was carried over? Was that authoritative enough? I guess I'm not so sure would have been better. Kim says they'd have to have incapacitated and carried him over. This man was more than a match for untrained dock workers. This man was more than a match. Really, he places his hand on the dead man's chest as if in preparation. Composure says, your central nervous system recognizes this gesture. It's the stations of the breath, ecclesiastic, religious in nature, a holdout from pre-Delorean burial rites. It takes him 2 seconds to perform, then... Esprit de Corps says, somewhere in Jamrock North, a small wood shed behind Rosencrantz Row, Detective Nick Feuerbach places his hand to the chest of a small corpse, no larger than a monkey. It's raining outside. Light drizzle. There is darkness in the shed. I'm getting a memory? Elsewhere yet, an obese female sits in a wicker chair, her silhouette ball-like against a window. Outside, Grand Coron. The day is turning dim for Sergeant Mac Torson. Hand extended, he approaches to make sure she is dead more than anything else. And so all across Jamrock, Coal City, GRIH, 42 deceased persons found today, 42 stations of breath. Really? We should start the post-mortem, Kim says. Turn the page. The corpse cannot feel Kim's hand on his chest. It no longer meaningfully interacts with its surroundings. A thicket of boxes and lists on red copier paper tries to answer why. Should I go to this? Tell me something, dead man. He says, shoot, loony rooney. Enough. There's nothing new. Okay, one, internal examination. Summary. Clothes, Kim begins. The deceased wears armored boots and white briefs. The make of the briefs is Babardine, I think. Let's see. He turns the body onto its side to check the underwear label. Kuno says, see, it's happening. Kim says, Babardine, yes. Inexpensive, size M, color white. Kunoes's disappointment is palpable. The red-haired thing was expecting something more lurid. Oh, brother. Write it down. The rest of the clothes have been removed post-mortem by scavengers in order to get to the victim's ceramic armor. Officers are in search of the missing pieces. Removal of the boots is left for processing. Jama says, it would be clever of you to omit the boots altogether, sire. If you are to keep them for yourself, as you ought to, you deserve them more than anyone else. When am I going to get them? Drama says, patience. After the autopsy, before the body is taken away, there will be a window of opportunity after the lieutenant has gone to sleep. I hope this has helped you, my liege. I like the way Drama talks to me. Okay, omit the boots. The boot has a serial number. He twists the dead man's foot. It's E50.100.1000. The lines between the plates are in the shape of the alphanumerical. The number is purposefully concealed by the design. Wait, write it down? I'm supposed to be omitting the boots. I don't have any other choice other than to write it down. Okay, I'm not sure. Okay, Kim says tattoos. He stands up, feet planted on either side of the body. The upper torso is covered in a single, continuous tattoo resembling a map of the night sky. It reaches from the right shoulder to the heart. The ink is blue and white. The assistant has a color photograph of the markings to be added to the case files as document A1. The photo is taken on the scene using a Trigat Mini, or Trigat Mini. The deceased has a belt for airlifting cargo around his neck, tied with the hangman's knot. Color yellow, length 3 meters. There's a buckle on the other end. He produces a measuring tape. Well-nourished, athletically built, measuring 1.80 meters, generally consistent with age 42. Preservation is good. Ambient temperature below freezing. Body hair is light brown. Distribution is consistent with age. He kneels in to get a better look. The deceased had male pattern baldness. Hair is combed back, short. I'm not going to touch his hair. Okay, write it down. Short, light brown, male pattern baldness. Lividity is consistent with hanging. The head is congested. Contusions are present on the head, chest, and thighs, consistent with stones thrown post-mortem. Low velocity? Kuno says, low velocity! The kid explodes. You think Kuno doesn't know what you're talking about? Velocity was max! talking crap about Kuno's velocity. The lieutenant pays no heed. In addition, there are bite marks on the face, scalp, and chest, consistent with predation. Kuno wasn't going to know what I'm writing here, unless he grabs the thing from me, the journal. Let's just write it down normally. Ligature mark. The lieutenant produces a small folding knife. With the other hand pulling on the belt, he starts cutting into the polyester. The stench is hard. After a while, it's obvious the material cannot be cut. The steel wiring, he concedes, breathless. It's too much of it. We need to remove the belt so we can get to the ligature mark. Interfacing says, you got just the right tool for that, the chain cutters. Good thing we got these chain cutters. Always good to think ahead. Now, he points to the rope squeezing the dead man's neck. We need to cut the belt to see the ligature mark below, carefully, with as much precision as you can. See, my pig is gonna cut his head off. No, he ain't. C looks blasé. Your pigs are boring. Beep. Ooh. I'm not your pig, Kuno. You are, he says with calm certainty. You're Kuno's pig. Can I... The hangman is down. Perform a closer inspection of his body, arriving at cause of death. This will need a form to be filled in four parts. I can't access... What part is done? Get the body down, right? Yeah, all the way down there. Yeah. Am I already holding that? Hold on. Oh, this thing? Alright. Look for a good spot to cut. The belt is equally tight around the whole circumference of his neck, swelling over the edges like white bread, rising from the yeast. Ugh. Interfacing says, the knot is the weak spot. The chain cutters fit in there. Steady now, like a flower arranger. Two cuts, and it should come loose. Okay. Now that Interfacing gave instructions, we have plus three. Minus one for stupid argument with Kuno. Alright, let's try to cut the belt off. Wish me luck. Yay! After some deliberation, you sink the cutters into the knot, tying the belt together. You squeeze the rubber handles together, sweat forming on your brow. Press down. Snap! The knot is slashed. Another cut, and the belt falls apart like a flower bouquet, revealing the dead man's neck and the dark red ligature mark around it. The lieutenant kneels closer, running his finger along the dark red groove, until there's a gap. The rope rises to a point, leaving a gap in the ligature mark. The suspension point is in the back of the neck. Physical instrument says, as it ought to. This is where its grip on the curdled meat is gentlest pulling up. Yeah. Imaging is observed on the skin above and below the ligature mark. The mark is well pronounced, consistent with a drop from 1 or 1.5 meters. Chest is intact. He presses down on it. Normal contour. Abdomen is protuberant. Pelvis intact. Genitalia. He pulls down the man's underpants. Okay, Kunos, here we go. Kuno says, now! It's gonna happen, see? I knew it! Empathy says, this is clearly what they've been waiting for. Ever since the autopsy began, the lieutenant is trying to make it as boring as possible. Genitalia is male and unremarkable. No evidence of injury. Inspect. No. Write it down and move on. Back is symmetrical and intact. He struggles to turn the corpse on its side. Upper and lower extremities are intact but asymmetrical. There are combat injuries on the right hand, thigh, and hip. Combat injuries. Pain Threshold says bullets have bitten little pieces out of him. It must have been excruciating, especially the hip. Before you is a temple of pain that knew little tenderness in life. In addition, I see smaller residual scars, too numerous to count, covering about 30% of his skin. Visual Calculus says, from wounds sustained over two, maybe more, decades, dispersal and accumulation indicates long and active combat duty. Last item, hands. He takes the man's right hand in his, inspects it, then moves on to the other hand. Pick up the hand. Inland Empire says, his flesh is cold, icy. Pleased to meet you, the hangman says. Where are you from, and what's your name? My name is... I'm only screwing with you. I know where you're from. From Cappadocia. And your name is Il Cabo. What can I do you for, Il Cabo di Cappadocia? Pleasure's all mine. Tell me, are you a temple of pain and a stranger to tenderness? You get me, Cobo. I feel like you were once for tenderness and kisses yourself, but then crap went south, and now you're ahead of even me on the pain front. We should do this more often. Be close like this, I mean. Hands are clean, the lieutenant concludes. The dead man's fingers slip from your hand, cold and sausage-like. No sign of injury from struggling. Were we expecting any? I was. Maybe I'm just not seeing them. Honestly, the stench is making it hard for me to think at the moment. Oof. He turns to the side to breathe. It's not enough. He buries his face in the sleeve of his jacket. You hear a muffled voice.
It's all for the external. Well done. What next?
2. Internal examination summary. Central nervous system, he says, and then concludes abruptly. I have nothing. Do you have anything on this man's central nervous system? Conceptualization says, of course, there's a moral to be drawn from it, a moral to this story. If I may add the moral of this story? What would that be? He looks at you inquisitively. The dead man looks too, with barely contained excitement to hear the moral of his story. The brain is very vulnerable to compromises in its blood supply. The lieutenant grins. I think that may well be the moral of every story, officer. All right, N.A. Good. Must go skeletal. Purge fluid is coming from the mouth. He gets close to the mouth hole, eyes squinting from the stench. Not injury-related. Eyes and tongue protuberant. Hyoid bone? Let's see. With his eyes almost closed, Lieutenant puts his hand on the dead man's throat and begins to massage it gently. A rotting smell erupts from the mouth. Purge fluid runs down his lips, black and viscous. My god, I can barely read this without gagging. Kunoes says, yeah, check that bleep off. The hyoid bone is fractured, he says after a while. The rest of the musculoskeletal system is intact, unremarkable. Back hunched, as if in prayer, he begins to pry open the dead man's jaws. Respiratory system, he stops to exert more force. Both hands are used. Oh, jeez. Oral cavity shows no lesions. The victim has received dental implants, possibly after a combat wound. Mouth swollen, hemorrhaging present in mucose of the lips and mouth. Look inside the dead man's mouth. Why? No scream, no sigh of relief rises from the darkness inside. It's humid there. Sickly sweet air, unlike anything living. You feel like you're about to throw up again, straight in that mouth of his. Ugh. Pain Threshold says, no, you don't. You can keep it in. You can keep anything in.